The nitrogen, or the nitrogen fixed by the lupine, that allows you to grow demanding tree species like black cottonwood, Alaska asp, in what used to be just the sand. Just sand without any vegetation, no nitrogen in the soil. But this, on the other hand, lodgepole pine can get by without any lupine or very much nitrogen. I don't know exactly what it is. Whether it's a deep tap root or whether it's the mycorrhizae that allows it to recover what little is available in the soil, or whether it is one factor that came in a few years ago when researchers at the University of Washington found out that there were free living nitrogen fixing bacteria on the needles of pines and Douglas fir, and actually even some broadleaf trees. I don't know, but it stands pretty clear. So let's just walk here through the pine and then a little ways into the poplar area here. Here's more of this Arctic lupine, the lower one. You see the other one next to it, you can see the difference in height. One interesting thing here is that esky, which we call this horsetail, it's all around here in the sand, but usually at rather low densities. But it really likes to grow under lodgepole pine and even under lupine. It thrives much better here under other vegetation than by itself. And in other countries, this is not a typical species just found on barrens, coasts or sands, but rather it's a forest understory species. So it prefers that, obviously. In the autumn of 1995, I think I put something about 500 to 700 seedlings in the ground because I was a bit uneasy. It's too exposed or too windy or something. But in fact, they all survived. The only thing that's kind of bothered them is that sometimes there's a lot of snow accumulation on little spots like this, so you get some snow breakage. But around a few years later, I think it was around the turn of the century, maybe 2002 or 3, I started throwing into the ground what used to be just sand here, unrooted cuttings of, on the one hand, hooker willow, jorvavidr, and black cottonwood. Various clones. Hooker willow is actually a great species for this part of the country. Wherever you see a willow here that's doing well, it's a hooker willow. Hérna reynir. I'm pointing out a small seedling of rowan that's here. I've never planted any rowan here, but it's coming with the birds and it's coming up out of the lupine, sometimes in dense numbers. Og hérna drumbaræktin. Now in 2015, we were carrying out experiments when I was working at Mokilsá. Well, Johanna Ólafsdóttir was doing a master's thesis and preparing that. So she was putting up experiments with all kinds of unrooted cuttings of black cottonwood. You know, some small, some longer, and some thick and whatnot. And the extreme case were just logs of black cottonwood. So it's a very easy method if you don't have to carry it very far. Here's the main pest of poplars. This is the Fratora vitilene asparglitta. It doesn't really harm very much the poplar, but it's a real harmful pest when it comes to some other species like the native aspen especially, and Vidya, Salix myrcinifolia. It totally devours it and finishes. It's mainly a problem with poplars when they're at the younger stage, but not when they reach that height. Probably because these adults are kind of scared of heights. Yeah. Or they blow easily away off the leaves when it's windy and they're high above the ground. Now this is just part of the same plot, but here they're kind of out in the open without any lupine around them. So there's more dieback and slower growth. Totally barren without any even moss or empetrum nigrum. It was just sand. Coming back to the issue of can you afforest Icelandic deserts, I think it's quite easy actually. It just takes a little more effort. We're only a few kilometers from the coast here, so you get salt sprays. And we have had winters when the pines turn red in the spring. But here there was less survival. In most cases, I have at least one seedling growing from every spot where it was seeded. I tried to put some stones around them, but most of them just blew away during the winter. And just on the other side, I tried the same for birch. and it just doesn't work. Birch is a hopeless species in Iceland. Icelandic birch should not be planted or sown. My birch is just to inoculate them, and you know, before spreading it out, it's easy to handle it that way. Because you know how it is with birch seed, even on a day like this when there's a little wind, it doesn't go down there, it blows somewhere to the side or all over, or you get it in your face. So it's easier to kind of mix it with soil and then throw a spot. But the soil I was using to mix it with obviously had a lot of lodgepole pine seed in it. So if you see anything surviving, it's usually lodgepole pine that came up that way. But just a few meters in, the trees are straight. So it's just the outer border that was affected, not the trees behind here, as you see in a minute. Scots pine, here are a few cases, instances of that. A lot of self-seeded lodgepole pine, like this one, next to a Scots pine. And then there's Douglas fir in here as well. And the larches here are kind of leftovers of experiments with European larch, Japanese larch, European-Japanese hybrid, and Russian-Siberian larch. Most of the Russian and Siberian larch is actually dead long ago, but nearly all the European and Japanese are still surviving. And the Japanese larch is actually getting to become quite interesting here. It's no longer damaged by autumn frost. It's getting to be straight, grow straight without any damage. I'm just saying, I fool around with all kinds of things here, sometimes just alone, and sometimes with all kinds of forest nerds, including the current forestry director of Iceland, Thröstur Eysteinsson. He once sent me a batch of seedlings of three provenances. One was something that was produced from seed in Denmark, or from a provenance that's very much used in Iceland. This one closest to us, the one behind, is actually the same origin, but seed produced in Egilsstaðir. And then a very southern one where Hlynur is standing, from British Columbia. Much too southern for Iceland normally, but they are all pretty similar. There was hardly any mortality in any of this. I've never fertilized anything here. I just kept this fertilizer free and let the alders do the trick of fertilizing. The mycorrhizae and the Frankia strains that we've been experimenting with, so they would be somewhere in a safe haven somewhere. And I never expected to survive. They were about this high. I had to cut them down to about 5-10 centimeters, cut off a lot of the roots. They've been growing in containers for 5 years. But they all survived. But what's happened since then is that you're getting more and more mortality of the sitka alder, but the thin-leafed alder is doing just as well. And then I interplanted it with a lot of birch and sometimes Douglas fir, and you can just look at the birches. They're starting to look healthy now that they have their roots in the alder, and there are several Douglas fir in here that are doing very well among the alder. So that's something you can really do when you have a derelict land like this, a desert, and you want to turn it into a productive forest. You just start off by planting alder and then interplanting it with something else, whether it be spruce or birch or Douglas fir or whatever. And there are lots of things happening. Sometimes it's spring frosts affecting some individuals of sitka alder. We've had also insect problems with sitka alder, which we don't have with thin leaf alder. For example, the wasp that's affecting birch, Birkithiella, it seems to affect this sitka alder as well. And there are some lepidopterans that are also chewing up all the leaves of the sitka alder, but leaving the other ones alone. So it's probably a host of factors, but they're affecting the individuals very differently in sitka alder. I mean, there are some that are just fine, and then there are some that are dead, and then there are many in between. We see quite a bit of natural regeneration of sitka alder here, but it's only close to the alder plants. It's somewhere within the region where the root system is. I'm sure the seed will blow tens of meters away. You don't find any natural regeneration, it's just around the mothers. And that's probably having to do with the Frankia symbiosis.